Living on a lighted stage approaches the unreal for those who think.
Hello, and welcome to the LeStudio documentary series, Temple of Sound. My name is Kevin, and I will be your host. Right off the bat, I want to give a shout out to two good friends, Kirk and Kyle, who also made the travel with me. Without their help, this wouldn't have been possible. We all were a part of the scrounging of the footage and photography while we had the day there on site at LeStudio. Now, for all of you that have been longtime LeStudio channel subscribers here on YouTube, your wish has finally been granted, because now with the upgrades of some cameras such as this, sound and lighting equipment, there was finally a way to put the narrative into this the way I always wanted to. There was always a mystery, as I said in the past updates, of how was I going to assemble all of this footage together. Well, finally, after a lot of scrounging and a lot of personal purchases, I was able to get the equipment and the bare bones materials required to actually at least host this in the proper way before getting into all the footage and photography that we did on site 2 years ago. So why is LeStudio significant to Rush fans, or why should it be? Well, to us, we felt, because of course, first and foremost, moving pictures was recorded there. In truth, Permanent Waves onwards, 8 albums were created there, and it was sort of Rush's hallowed retreat in the wilderness, to where they could let the juices flow and create some of the best material that they've ever done in all of their eras. And that is a very significant reason that this recording studio wasn't just a recording studio. It was sort of Rush's Abbey Road, so to speak. Just like the Beatles and Pink Floyd utilized Abbey Road Studios in the UK for their definitive albums from those eras, Rush and LeStudio were sort of synonymous for some of their most prolific and still to this day worshipped material. It should also be stated up front that this production has no affiliation to Mr. Andre Perry, the original creator of LeStudio, nor the current landowners, property owners of that building and surrounding lands. Those property owners did help us, however, to gain access to the building and get inside for the day trip that we did spend there back in 2011, which was, of course, crucial and the only inception to this whole thing in the first place. This will be a multi-part series due to the expansive nature of all the material that we do want to cover to tell the LeStudio story in full. Beyond just what you may read on a Wikipedia page, a lot of Rush fans just aren't aware of what this place really meant in the career course and the creative process of Rush, nor what it even operated like or looked like, and its backstory, and why it's fallen into disrepair at this point. Very similar to last year's documentary called Sound City, which was produced by Dave Grohl of the Foo Fighters, the Sound City recording studios in California closed after many, many years of service and dozens and dozens and dozens, hundreds probably, of platinum albums and albums that we've all heard and loved throughout the years. Dave Grohl saw that niche of sort of digging in and telling the backstory of a long-lost relic that was just basically coming to its end, and he did. Now, of course, this will not be of any budget of that nature, and we won't, unfortunately, have all of the artists and engineers on here telling their stories of yesteryear. There is one big significant difference, though. Sound City is truly gone. LeStudio is still there. And that's what was big about this adventure, was the fact that you could go back in the forest and find this dead, lost recording studio, very similar to visiting the Titanic on the bottom of the ocean, but it was still there. And the ability to gain access, to go inside and actually walk those halls and rooms of where not only Rush, but dozens of major artists created some of their most prolific pieces, was just something that we couldn't let go. That's what's going to make this a little bit different than Sound City, because yes, we will be hearkening back to the past, but we're also visiting the present, which is very significant, and letting you see inside. Now, as I said before, this documentary will be broken up into several different parts, and the reason for that is we're going to go through the story almost like chapters. And I know you just want to get inside and see what it all looks like, and we will get to that point. But for those who weren't even aware of LeStudio, or its existence, or that Rush recorded those albums there, or anything like that, we're going to go right back to the beginning and really start with how it all began, which is why this particular installment will be the beginning. So how did all this happen? Well, Kirk and Kyle and I ended up going to a Rush show in Montreal, Quebec, and part of that trip from Nova Scotia to Quebec was to actually make a day trip the next day to go see LeStudio in the forest as it is now. We've seen so many of the videos of people with their iPhones going around the property, peeking in windows, sneaking through the bushes, and so on. But we wanted to do it a little more involved, and that's how we sought out access to the actual building itself. Through a lot of research and digging, I ended up finding out who the current owner was and speaking to him personally. I basically made a bereaved, down on one knee, begging wish to somehow have access to the inside of the complex and actually go and, like I say, document, videotape, photograph what was going on there at this time and not be peeking through the windows. My wish was granted, which was amazing, and through the help of one of his staff, I was able to literally be guided with that staff person in tow, all of us, to go out to the facility in the forest and actually crack those locks and enter and have a look. So that's the background on this project. Now, let's roll the clock back and actually go back in time to the beginning, to Genesis. And actually start the LeStudio story where it began.
Okay, we're rolling, go.
LeStudio story starts in 1974. Mr. Andre Perry came up with the idea of creating a studio outside of the metropolitan type areas where most recording studios always are within cities. He wanted to go way out into the nature, into the forests, and build sort of what was he termed the first environmental recording studio. So what is an environmental recording studio? Well, the concept may be a little bit common today, but back then it was the one single place where you could go like a retreat to actually be embedded in the entire process for the duration of the project itself. So for example, when Rush decided to go there for the first time to record Permanent Waves, they basically moved there for a while. Now, Permanent Waves may have been recorded technically within, say, a month, as most albums back then were, but that particular month was spent at LeStudio, at the lake, in the forest, living in the cabins, going through the forest and actually going and visiting the studio, doing your tracks, eating there, sleeping there. You lived the experience. The entire creative process took place there at the facility. This, of course, eliminated all of the distractions of being within the city, leaving the facility and, say, going to a hotel room, eating in different restaurants, all the hustle and bustle of everything moving around. Very, very different. It's sort of like you're on vacation, but you're making an album. We'll be right back. Also revolutionary for LeStudio was the solid-state Logic Master System, the SSL console, the large, gigantic mixing board that was installed at the facility. That was only the second of its kind in the world. The first one, of course, being made and delivered to Abbey Road Studios in England.
Console, and what can you not say about it? It's mixed more number one hit singles than any other console that's ever been built, probably ever will be built, especially at this point.
With LeStudio and Andre Perry having that trump card, that second installment of the magical, wonderful SSL console, he actually gave input to the company for future revisions and versions for the third, fourth, fifth, and all of the other ones that came out, being the second owner of said product. Along with some of the particular Neve consoles, as the one, say, outlined in the Sound City documentary by Dave Grohl, the SSL console is still hallowed as one of the most amazing, if not the most holy, mixing consoles in the world, and LeStudio had one. Thank you.
big round 70s rock sound. Not that it's limited to that, but I think it's got that in its arsenal.
Working in partnership with Trident Audio Development, Universal Audio scrutinized and painstakingly reproduced the EQ section from one of these extremely rare desks. Originally commissioned for LeStudio in Canada, where it was used to record classic records for both Rush and The Police, the specific A-range console modeled for UA's plug-in was later purchased by the late singer-songwriter Elliot Smith and now resides at New Monkey Studio in Van Nuys, California.
Andre Perry wanted to get away from sort of the dark, mysterious, closed studios that were had no life. You just kind of went in there, plugged in instruments, and under the light, these very dim lights, sort of recorded, and that was it. You tried to get it down on tape, and bye-bye, you go home. Andre had a whole different philosophy. He wanted it to be such a nurturing environment for creativity, for swapping around ideas, for trying different things, and for God's sake, let the light in. If you notice, LeStudio is just emblazoned in glass windows on the backside facing the lake, and that was for a very particular reason. It was to open up the room and allow the creative juices to flow and not feel that you're so boxed in, and it's certainly not a dark place like you're in the dungeon or in solitary confinement when you're recording your album. Now, with all these amazing amenities at LeStudio, it ended up attracting a lot of people to actually want to use the facility. And I'm going to drag out my paper here and let you know some of the artists that actually produced things there. Now, of course, we all know about Rush, 8 albums, including the holy and the hallowed Moving Pictures. But here is the short list of who else recorded there that we may recognize. April Wine, Asia, Brian Adams, The Bee Gees, David Bowie, Cat Stevens, Chicago, Julian Clarke, Roberta Flack, Corey Hart, Ian Hunter, The Bare Naked Ladies, Catherine Lara, Kim Mitchell, Nazareth, The Police, Keith Richards, Sting, and the band called Toronto. Now, the lake where LeStudio was built is just on the outskirts of Morin Heights, and the lake eventually did end up being named Lake Perry after Andre Perry. He did buy property all around the lake, where, of course, he built the studio site itself, as well as a home that he did live in, and as well as sort of cabins and quarters for the musicians and the guests that were there actually utilizing the facility. Now, we'll utilize these Google Earth snaps to sort of zoom in and give you a rough idea of where LeStudio is located, Morin Heights, Quebec, and where it's situated in relation to that lake that you see in the Rush videos from the Moving Pictures era for Vital Signs, Limelight, and Tom Sawyer. When you look out those windows, when you see the shots from the lake, this is the particular lake, Lake Perry, where LeStudio and the additional facilities were built.
Merci! Merci beaucoup! Thank you so much! That was Moving Pictures from 1980, an album which we wrote about 60 miles north of here, near Saint-Sever, Morin Heights, Quebec. So bring it home.
Thank you.
Now, to continue with the creation story of LeStudio, Andre didn't just stop with the initial recording studio for sound. By the early 80s, he ended up expanding the building on the exact same site to be much, much bigger. It ended up growing sideways and incorporating a lot of new offices, facilities, and a large video editing facility that was put there to start getting into things other than just audio. Now, to go along with the video facility that he did expand into on the site, he did also construct a large sound stage attached to the building, as well as an electronic music suite full of the old synthesizers, synclaviers, those sort of technologies from the early 80s at the time. Now, Andre Perry, being a very ambitious man and totally headlong into all of this technology, sound, video, entertainment, the man just lives and breathes this stuff. He ended up outgrowing the LeStudio facility in the Laurentian Mountains on Lake Perry, and he ended up expanding and growing into something he called Group Andre Perry. Of course, he built a Group Andre Perry facility in Montreal, but then later he built one almost identical in Washington, D.C., and he built one in San Francisco, and also one in Silicon Valley. So Group Andre Perry was, of course, his exquisite masterpiece. But LeStudio remained sort of at its core. That was sort of his initial dream place. That was his labor of love. As the years went on and as artists came and went, the music industry, of course, did change, and the way things sounded, not so wooden, not so warm. It's not that the studio wasn't capable, but of course, people were just looking for more packaged, parceled, more synthetic type of places, and LeStudio sort of ended up trailing off that niche as years went on. So the LeStudio torch just kind of got picked up by essentially the staff. That's the best way to describe it. And they continued to, as professionals, run the facility, do the productions and recordings that came through the door, and it's just slowly sort of made its way to where there just really wasn't that much business left anymore to sustain the place in a way that it could maintain all of the staff. And then leaves started to drop. People started to have to leave. And it sort of just started becoming much more bare bones and a lot less activity happening there as years went by. So now we're getting into sort of approaching the mid-2000s, and the facility just isn't getting the work that it needs to sort of economically sustain itself. And the guys who are now holding the torch that had taken it from Andre, the guys that had been there for so long and knew the place like the back of their hand, and this was sort of, this was their instrument, they ended up realizing there was just really no way to sort of sustain it as this, you know, retreat where artists come and record. They weren't really getting any more recording contracts to actually do the production there any longer. So basically, they just had to come to a hard decision, and they decided they had to put it up for sale and let it go. So this is where we can sort of dig up some materials from that time, now that we're not too far back. The facility was up for sale, and it was actually purchased at one point, and a developer bought it. And a group of investors purchased the lands, the LeStudio property, all as one big package. And, of course, there were cut sheets from that area that we can certainly look at. We'll be right back. And of course, the original plan by these investors was basically to turn that entire lake into a cottage retreat for people to buy lots and cottages all around the lake. And it was all going to be developed into sort of this upscale cottage country. The LeStudio facility itself was originally planned for this development to become a day spa. In other words, to be entirely converted into this upscale day spa where all of the cottage owners around the lake could have this facility for themselves as part of their own sort of land and subdivision for their very own use. It also sort of was proposed to become sort of a club, like a nightclub, where they could all go relax and party. But of course, with it being right on the end of the lake there, it sounded like, you know, it would be something that would, you know, be a perfect anchor to all of the properties around the lake. Now, long story short, and we don't want to delve too much into this part because this is the part that's a little more sensitive because it's current affairs. The current owners that did, the investor group that did buy the 240-some acres plus the LeStudio property, they haven't done anything with it yet. And it has been many, many years since the purchase was made, but LeStudio still stands as is. It has been gutted inside, as we will see in future installments, but it, as far as a standing building, has not been touched on the outside, and no development has been done to the property. Now, in speaking to the city developer, and more accurately, town developer, because Morin Heights isn't very large, he did disclose to me that the group of investors that did purchase the lands have, of course, applied for all the different permits for development. They've been approved on different levels, initial levels, to start surveying and making certain developments in small steps, you know, not doing the whole lake at once, but sort of in phases. But nary a branch has been cut down. There have been, you know, of course, things measured and different things approved. But as it stands right now in 2014, the ground has not been dug to pour one foundation yet, folks. Now, for all the diligent work that Rush fans have done actually sneaking up there and visiting LeStudio to check up the last couple years, we are, of course, rest assured that nothing has happened to it because we can see that. We have had people there that can attest to that. Nothing has really changed inside since we have been there in 2011 to take the footage that you will be seeing throughout this documentary series. It all still looks the same. Now, just to take a top-down look at the facility as it stands right now, this is the way LeStudio looks on the inside. Now, I'm not talking footage here, but we're going to do a bird's eye view from a diagram to scale of exactly the way LeStudio as a building is laid out now. Now, of course, nothing is furnished any longer. There's really nothing left in there as far as anything, you know, desks, equipment, you know, it's just, there's some scattered junk, but basically these walls that you're seeing in these diagrams are basically the way the building is diced up right now and the way it existed. The key point that I want you to notice is that one end is the original LeStudio. This is the original construction from back in 1974-75, where Andre just started with just the studio. And that is, of course, where all the music was recorded. And that particular facility was, relative to the rest of the place, only probably one-third of the complex that exists there now. And when we first got there, it's kind of a funny side story. We were going through all of the building and so on, but we could never find, like, where is the recording studio? Because it was way down at the other end, and we were working our way so slowly, we ended up getting to the audio section of the building, the famous recording studio portion at the end. But it is seated, that sort of final one-third of the building, that was the original LeStudio facility that you see in the beginning, say, of those, again, Rush Moving Pictures videos of Limelight, Tom Sawyer, and Vital Signs. All of the rest of it was expanded later and is much more modern, has a slightly different build, even though the exterior is all the same with sort of those very distinct hardwood shakes. They look like shingles. That is certainly all the way around, but that was the original module down at one end. And you can notice that again by looking at the videos. You can see it sitting on the hill up off the lake, and it's, you know, only so big. But of course, when we look at later photos, you can see how much of a sprawling complex it had become. Of course, you can also see the difference in the wood siding. Time has taken its toll from when it was so bright and yellow looking to, of course, today. It almost looks like someone has set the wood on fire in certain areas. It's just gone to total black. Of course, nothing has been set on fire on the exterior. It's just the way that, of course, the wood is aging and naturally darkening down in the elements. Now, moving across the center of the building, you can see different facilities that were added in for more of the recreational and relaxation areas. There was the sort of the rec room where there was the pool table that you do see in videos from back in the day from both, say, Nazareth, April Wine, and Rush, of course. The that middle section where there was sort of the cappuccino bar, and there was the relaxation areas of nice couches. And of course, these areas were all adorned in the gold and platinum records of the artists that recorded there. And of course, Andre was always sent his copies to proudly post on the walls. And there were some offices and so on. But again, it was all put together to be sort of a place that when you weren't in the audio booth or in the recording studio room, you could sort of exit there and sort of just relax. And if your stuff wasn't being worked on, you know, you could just hang out. And getting to the far end, there's this just massive, the building just becomes massive at one end, where of course there is the soundstage room, which is a large, oh my goodness, probably, I don't know, 40, 50 feet by 40 or 50 feet. It's a large square room with a very high ceiling, probably three stories. And that was sort of a soundstage area for doing a video and film production in that facility there, to play with, of course, the video editing suites, which is the large sort of room at one end that was done to have all of the video monitors on the wall and all of the work desks and the bays for doing all of that video editing work. A whole different feel at that end of the building. Now, going back to the other end, the audio end, of course, the recording studio end that we're most interested in, that, of course, is the room that has the large floor-to-ceiling windows where you can see the lake at one end of the studio room. Of course, that's the room where those Rush videos took place in that we remember so dearly. And of course, the booth is off to one side through a large double-paned glass window. And of course, there is a vocal booth and all sorts of things. We will get to seeing all of that up close, and of course, seeing it the way it looks today. But that's going to be the room that we focus on in future segments the most. Even though we do have footage to take you through the whole facility from top to bottom, back to front, that will be, of course, where we end up at the very end, because, of course, as Rush fans, that's the most important part. Now, last but not least, there's this, the famous LeStudio neon sign that, of course, identifies the room instantly when you see it in the videos. It's what's stuck in so many of our heads for all these decades. That is a sign that was mounted in the paneling on the wall, and of course, as we'll see in future segments where we examine the ruins and the relics of the way the room looks now, that spot is still there. The sign is gone as far as the tubing, but of course the transformer is still there. That's one little relic that's so interesting and important to still be there today in 2014, stuck to the wall with the wires hanging down that used to connect to those neon tubes that said, LeStudio. So to wrap up this installment, we're going to bring this to a close. This installment was meant to be more of an overview of the LeStudio story, just in brief, where we go from the inception to sort of the rise and the acclaim, to the expansion, to the decline, and then sort of to the current state of affairs where we have the current ownership and the place is sort of in limbo, in danger, right? So we wanted to just get all that out. So it's covered now, and you can see LeStudio in the context that it is. And then, of course, we'll get to that footage. The footage. You want to see that footage and the photos that we took inside the building. And that's, of course, what the segments will be for coming up. We'll be to slowly take you through the building. We'll start in one area, work that segment, and visit that. We'll work through other areas of the building and other segments. And then, of course, a segment, maybe two, will be dedicated at the end for the actual audio recording studio, the part that we're so interested in, of course. That rush part of the story at the end of the building. So we'll eventually make it there. Less of me as a talking head, more footage. And I do want to apologize in advance. The footage itself was fly by the seat of your pants. It was, you know, HD footage, but it was done on a very inexpensive camera that wasn't the best at low light. So it'll be a little grainy in some of the darker rooms and so on, but I think you'll be bound to forgive us. The photos are typically sharp as a tack, and we'll spin those in with the footage and try to, again, give you a walkthrough as if you were there. And because, hey, 99.999% of us will never even get to visit the site, period. And then 99.999999% of us won't ever get inside the facility. I bet you no one's been in since we unlocked the door and left. After we were done that day to take this footage, there'd be no reason to go in there. And of course, as YouTubers and other visitors has confirmed in years since, it all just looks the same, folks. It's pretty much the way it looks right now. So we'll keep our fingers crossed that there won't be a wrecking ball going through there anytime soon. And, you know, there may be a continuing story for this channel as developments happen later. But for right now, I bid you farewell from segment number one. We'll see you in the other segments and as this adventure continues. Thanks for tuning in. Shot.